Four nurses from Whittingham Hospital near Preston are to spend Halloween in one of Britain's most haunted houses. Organiser of the sponsored sleep-in, Mavis McAteer, said we're down-to-earth people but can't help feeling a little apprehensive.
Chingle Hall, supposedly the most haunted house in Britain, was built in 1260. It was the birthplace of the Catholic martyr St. John Wall, who was executed in 1679 for his beliefs. But Chingle is perhaps more famous for the inexplicable happenings that have taken place there.
I sort of fell, you know, again, the footsteps underneath, and then looking over there, I just caught an indefinable shape going round the back of the door.
I was a sceptic, but there comes a time when you've got to say, there is something, there is something else. And Chingle Hall is certainly something else.
Well, there we are, that's the tape made by the BBC 8 years ago. And interesting, really, because here's a chap who's gone away and he's done six ghost hunts and done six broadcasts and come up with nothing. And then somebody said, go to Chingle. And you've heard the product. Now, I'm not going to tell you a lot of other things that may or may not happen. There are a whole host of things that can happen and that sometimes people do experience. What tonight's really about is for you to, if you like, conduct your own experiments. And we would suggest that quite a lot of things that happen, you may find would be really quite subtle, not sort of obvious big bang things. If you're scared at all tonight, worried, or anything like that, then do come and wake us up. That's what we're here for.
Jackie, why are you doing this? Why are you spending the night in a haunted house?
Really, to raise money for the hospital.
But why this way? I mean, why a haunted house?
Well, there must be easier ways to do it, but it was just suggested and it seemed a fun idea at the time.
Do you believe in ghosts?
I'm not sure. Maybe I shall know in the morning.
I think I'd like to experience something. That's
why? What would it?
Well, probably to show me that there's something after this. I think I probably feel that, there's something after this if I do have any experiences. At the moment, I don't believe that there is, so we'll just see.
A lot of people might say that you were slightly balmy.
Well, I might agree with a lot of people.
There are more recorded apparitions seen in Great Britain and Ireland than in any other country in the world.
I suppose I've always seen ghosts. For me, there's absolutely nothing unusual about it. I don't think there's anything to be frightened of. They've always been friendly. Well, we moved here in April 1979, and one of the first things we did was put central heating in. And because the cellar had an earth floor, my husband and son decided to lay a concrete floor so that the anthracite wouldn't sink into it. And Mac laid the last yard, and he picked up this object and he said, "What's this? It's so heavy." He washed it, and there was this, you know, huge crucifix. We had various local people who were interested in archaeology, and we had the church people came, both sides, you know, and they were very divided. One lot said it was, or they thought it was, Victorian. The other said it was medieval. They were all certain it was made of iron and lead. They were all certain it had come off a tomb because there was a stone on the back of it. It hadn't been nailed anywhere. But as yet, we've still not found anyone that can give us any real information about it. I would like to know about it, because it was after finding that that I first saw Dominic. I was washing up in the kitchen, and coming from right to left, underneath the kitchen window, was this hooded figure, and I thought it was Mike, my husband, but he didn't come in through the back door. I thought, that's rum, so I looked outside, nobody there. Came back, continued washing up. I saw him again, coming from the same direction, not going back. So I went out and peered round the corner of the kitchen. There was nobody there. And that's when I realised it wasn't Mike. And I realised, for some reason, it was a cow I'd seen.
Have you seen Dominic since?
Oh, yes, many times. Many, many times.
Where do you normally see him?
Well, usually, there's no specific place. I've not seen him outside again. He's usually coming, he comes down the stairs and walks along through the living room, and if the kitchen door's open, he sort of walks into the kitchen and then just disappears. Or if it's closed, he'll walk through the door. He's got a thinnish moustache. His face is tan. His hands are tan, like as if he's Spanish or Italian.
Have you ever spoken to him?
Yes, once. He did a bit of a dance and he said, 112 Alera. I said, don't be silly, Dominic. I don't know why I gave him the name Dominic, but I did. Anyway, don't be silly, it's 123 Alera. Isn't there a song, you know, 123 Alera, I saw Sister Sarah. Anyway, he said, no, 112 Alera. Now, I don't know what that means. He's got such merry, fresh, merry eyes that twinkle, and he always looks so as if life is one huge bowl of cherries, you know. He always makes me feel good. He doesn't droop when he moves, you know. Everything about him is alive. He was like someone from out of the Inquisition, and then he's not. His cheeks are slightly hollow.
Is he a nice ghost?
Oh, yes. This is lovely. He's sweet.
He came striding out of the mist, raincoat flapping in the wind. Then I noticed there were no footprints in the snow and knew that he was a ghost.
I felt he was evil and I was absolutely terrified, and I knew the only way to get out was to get past him. So I made a dash to get out, and as I went past, I could feel him pushing me down the stairs.
A mist started to rise up from the body, going to the ceiling, and we both watched it, absolutely petrified, as it seemed to form the shape of the body.
When we pass over, it is our essential selves that survive, our true personality, bearing our character as it was at the moment of death. However, there are those whose characters are vitally attached to earthly things, perhaps to a loved one or to some particular place that figured much in their lives or in the circumstances of their death. These spirits are reluctant to progress further into eternity and so become trapped between this world and the next. So when I hear of a haunting, I do deeply search into the haunter and then find words and ceremony that the spirit will both understand and respond to.
Kate Babington was born in 1634, the daughter of the governor of Tynemouth. Not only was she a great beauty, but she was a deeply religious lady. She was a Puritan with sympathies with the Covenanters, and during the Long Parliament, she had the local vicar evicted from his pulpit by the son of her blacksmith. installed her own minister. However, at the restoration of the monarchy, the vicar was reinstated, and he exacted his revenge by imprisoning her in her own tower at Harnham, where she remained for 2 years until she died. It is said that her ghost, for hundreds of years, has haunted the place. The present owner, a grand old man called John Wake, has invited me to go up and investigate. Is it true that a previous owner of this hall actually tried to shoot the ghost of Kate Babington?
Oh, yes, yes.
What did he do?
Oh, well, he thought that was the ghost, the dragon, you see.
Oh.
He thought that he shot it, you see.
I don't think Kate's ghost would frighten anybody. She was so beautiful.
No, I think she was more beautiful than the dragon.
Than the dragon.
But he mistook the dragon. Dragon for the ghost, you see.
Yes.
And then he went up into the room and shot it up the stairs. Uh-huh. As a pellet. Uh-huh. In the woodwork up the stairs. Uh-huh. Where he shot up. But the first shot was at that last eye, you see. And all these wealthy families, they all had a crest and a coat of arms.
Yes.
Aye, that's the Babington crest.
How vain is the help of man, Kate Babington. Omnia vanitas, all is vanity. June the 9th, 1670.
Yes, she wrote that when she was imprisoned in this room with her diamond ring. How vain is the help of man? That would include her own husband, even. He hadn't helped her with her religion.
Well, she wrote this.
Yes.
Only 2 months before she died.
Yes.
In this room.
Yes, yes.
Why couldn't she escape from that window?
Oh, well, it's high out there, you know. You look down at the treetops. So she was a proper prisoner in here.
When she died, she was taken from this room. Where is she buried?
Oh, she's buried in a tomb in the garden, hewn out the solid rock. Mm-hmm. Her husband got hit. Yes, this is Dame Catherine's coffin. It's been here 300 years.
300 years?
Yes.
And what's this?
Oh, that's the, more or less, the headstone. She wrote this poem when she was in prison. My time is past, as you may see. I viewed the dead as you do me. Or long you lie as low as I, and some will look on me.
John, have you ever seen Kate's ghost?
Well, I haven't seen my ghost, but I know about presence. It's like a rushing mighty wind, you know. You don't see it, but it's there. In the presence of our spirits here, it's a really haunted house.
John has told me that there is a presence here, and I feel that there really is a nice presence, and that as her remains have lain for all these years on unconsecrated ground, I feel that I would love to give her a blessing, and perhaps then her soul may rest in peace.
We bless thy holy name, O Lord. For all thy servants departed this life in thy faith and fear, especially thy servant Catherine, beseeching thee to give us grace so to follow their good examples that with them we may be partakers of thy heavenly gifts. Grant this, O Father, Jesus Christ's sake, our only mediator and redeemer. Amen. Catherine, now that we have spoken these words of blessing, we hope that it will be to thee not only a blessing, but that you may find peace and rest everlasting.
had a motorbike and he was coming down the road somewhere near where you live, Lancaster, and he saw this lady walking down and she put her thumb up and they didn't wear their crash helmets or anything, so he slowed down. So she got on and he went a little way, and where she'd said she wanted to go, he slowed down to let her get off. Turned around and she wasn't there. So he went back and he drove up and down a couple of times and he was really worried, and he decided he'd go into a pub and have a double whiskey. So he was talking to the barman and he told him what had happened, and the barman said, "Well, you're not the first, it's happened once or twice on this stretch of the road."
One person in 10 will see a ghost in their lifetime, but not everyone will recognize it.
I've lived in Todmorden all my life, and that is 52 years. I spent quite a lot of time in my younger days with these two great aunts who brought my father up. They were in the 70s, 80s at the time. Ruth, yes, she was quite a lady, was Ruth. And when she was a young girl, she had an accident and she broke a shoulder. And that was how she got this deformed right shoulder. You couldn't mistake Ruth for anyone else. She always dressed in a navy blue French beret and a navy blue raincoat. And she had her black shoes on weekend and her highly polished black clogs for work. She must have been only about 5 foot, very small, but very quiet and very reserved. Emma, she was a lovely person. She loved young people, and I just used to love to go up and spend time with her and to live together at the top of Bride Street. It was one of those lovely late summer days, but it was a day that I'm always going to remember. Something that really extraordinary happened. I was working on the buses at the time. I went home, would be 9:15, and I decided to run my wife down into town, unless she was going shopping or something. And we were driving down Garden Street, and I suddenly saw this figure who I knew to be Ruth. And I drew past her and stopped. And I was just about to reverse to pick her up. And I looked over my left shoulder and I couldn't see her. And I said, "Well, she was there, where's she gone?" And my wife said, "Are you sure it was Aunt Ruth?" I said, "Yes." She said, "Ruth's been dead for 2 years. Well, it floored me, because it's quite true, she had been dead for 2 years, and yet I saw Ruth as clear as I can see you today. My wife said, "I wonder if Emma's all right." So I said, "Well, I'll take you down into town and I'll go back and see." The door was locked. And I looked through the curtains, and there I could see Emma sat in this little chair in front of the fireplace. The fire was out. And anyway, when we got in, I found Emma had fallen the night before, and she'd managed to crawl back to this chair, and her knee was very badly swollen. And I took her off to hospital. And Emma said at the time that we got back, she'd wish Ruth were there, because Ruth would have known what to do, but Ruth would have been able to get some help. But Emma didn't know at that time that Ruth actually had helped her.
Children under 10 are more likely to see ghosts than people of any other age.
My mum died in October 1982. On the anniversary of her death, on her birthday, Mother's Day, there's me and my children and my sister. We go to the crematorium where her ashes are, read the book of remembrance, leave flowers, go to the place where her ashes are buried, and there's a little plaque with a name, my dad's name, and a little bush. It's something we always do. It's habit with us now. It was a ritual sort of thing with us now. Well, we all thought the world of her. We all loved her very much, and she was always there if you ever needed her. Kids really loved her, especially our Nicola. She really loved her grandma, she was very close to her.
She'd always be there if you needed her, and she'd always be happy-go-lucky type person. And, well, she just used to do, you know, just keep us occupied and take us out and buy sweets and things like that. So, we got on really well.
First time Nicola saw ghost of my mum, about 2 years after she died, and she went home poorly from school. And I'd gone over to school to pick little boy up at home time.
I was reading a book in front of the fire, and I heard a noise. And I got up, and I turned round, and my mum was still there. And I just jumped up and I run.
You know, she looked so short, she was white. Said, "You look like you've seen a ghost." And she turned around and she said, "I have."
I thought she was cracking some sort of joke, and I didn't find it funny, actually, because I have. Oh, yeah, of course you have. So you've seen a ghost. So I saw my grandma. Of course you saw her, yeah. She's a figment of your imagination. She didn't believe me then. I had to get all going on at her all day, wasn't I?
Right, until tea time, yeah. After tea time.
And then I told her what she had on. I thought it was a dress. Because I don't know what a shroud, I don't know what a shroud looks like. So I thought it was a dress. And it was pink. And it was like quite a light shade of pink. Well, it wasn't really, it was like a fuchsia pink dress. And she had two crucifixes on her chest, and one was bigger than the other.
There was one that was on a chain round her neck. But one was just laid on her chest. And she said that she saw one hanging with nothing there. And there were only me and my sister who saw my mother the night before her funeral in chapel arrest. So there's no way she knew, because we never even talked about it after. So that's what really convinced me. And the pink shroud. There's no way she knew about it at all.
She just keeps popping up, and I don't expect her to touch friends for sometimes. It really does scare me. First time I saw her, I thought, I'm going crazy. Something wrong here. Brain disorder.
First time I've heard it, I thought, yeah, pull the other one. Because she's usually joking to me, is Nicola. And so, when she told me what she was wearing, I went down to ask my mum. And she said, yeah, it was true, and that convinced me.
Are you pleased to see her?
Yeah, I am. Because it just feels like she's... It's like she's still alive, do you know what I mean? It's like she's still alive.
Caused by a strong emotional event which leaves a trace in the haunted area.
Ghosts are hallucinations, possibly caused by a telepathic link
Every third person who sees a ghost will also have an out-of-the-body experience.
If you've ever been troubled by ghosts, then perhaps you should listen on. If you've ever thought you've had an experience with ghosts, then listen on. As I describe for you, Eddie Burks, who calls himself a clairsentient, somebody who talks about being present at the execution of a 35-year-old Londoner and feeling the sensation of that terror waiting on the gallows. And then I have to tell you that that experience took place in the 18th century. Eddie, perhaps you can explain that in a moment when you first told me what a clairsentient is and how do you use it?
A clairsentient is someone who is aware, not all the time, but part of the time, of a level of existence beyond the material and is aware of both sensations and very often entities in that realm. And how does one use it? Well, I use it myself in order to help release entities, people, who have died and haven't progressed to the level they should have done and who are trapped near the earth.
But is it true that you can actually experience that terror, the sensation of the rope around the neck?
Yes. I went through the experience with him, not in its full intensity, but enough to know what he experienced and actually feel some of the pain that he experienced and the terror that went with this.
This isn't your profession, is it?
No. I have been and am a civil engineer. In fact, I'm the founder partner of a quite prosperous consulting civil engineering practice. And these things that I've been talking about happen in my, so to speak, spare time.
Eddie, there's a lot of other questions I want to ask you. Let's just take a break. I'm talking with Eddie Burke, and as you've heard already, some very strange, perhaps bizarre experiences that he describes. And I gather that you're about to study one on an RAF station. Do you know very much about the circumstances?
No, all I know is that things have been happening on this airfield of a supernatural type, and I'm being asked to go and see what happens.
Just as I walked out of the door, a figure was stood just where you are. About 6 foot tall, quite broad-shouldered. It was a shadowy figure, and the figure just stayed there and then moved towards the left, towards the approach room door. And I was frightened to death, you know. I ran in and told my colleagues that I'd seen this figure, and they didn't believe me at first, you know. The next couple of nights, I actually came and stood in the landing waiting for this thing to come back, you know, and if I did see it, you know, I'd be able to say to people, look, it's here, you know. A couple of months later, I was coming down from local, coming down these stairs, and you know, I just walked past this door here, and this figure was stood there again.
The second time you saw it, did you feel equally fearful?
The second time I saw it, I wasn't as frightened as the first because I'd kind of got used to it, you know.
The reason I ask that is sometimes one feels the fear that the entity itself experienced, and sometimes that's the reason.
Yeah.
Or connected with the reason why it's stuck at this level.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm aware of some psychic atmosphere. It might be possible to get more closely involved in it, with it. I shall see in a moment. I wonder if I might do that. I'll sit on the stairs, I think, and see what happens. We'll see. I'll just go around here and sit down for a few minutes.
Does it affect us? Affect you, us watching you?
No, I'll try not to let it. The feelings I'm getting at the moment are that this man that you've seen was killed. I think somewhere in this vicinity, out on the airfield. I think it was just an ordinary accident. I think he was run down by a vehicle. At night. And his back was broken and he was in some considerable pain. He was put on a stretcher and I think he was brought into this building. At least temporarily. Oh, and he died here. There's a great weight on his mind that he'd not prepared himself or his family affairs for this sudden demise. And there's a great anxiety with him to put matters right. He doesn't understand, I think, that a lot of time has passed. This is why he's been here and why he appears. He's got unfinished business on his mind. Somebody's saying, thank you, Brenda. Thank you, Brenda, for playing your part in this, for helping to bring him to the attention of others. Your courage in coming back and waiting to make contact again has been very helpful to him. Thank you, Brenda. There's a wonderful feeling of light and lightness coming through now, and I feel I'm coming to the point where I can just hand over. I've done my bit. The team, the invisible team of spirits on the other side, are now taking him into their care. I say God bless him, and I leave him to their attentions, because now I know he will be quite safe. There's a great feeling of relief and joy coming through. Quite wonderful. He won't be seen again.
Great. Well done. Congratulations.
Thanks. Thank you, dear.
Strong experience. Great. Must be a very satisfying feeling, I should think, Eddie, isn't it?
Oh, it is. I mean, it's like turning the key and letting someone out of prison. It's wonderful, really.
Is it I mean, do you find it very physically exhausting, mentally exhausting?
I'm still carrying some of his, some of the, I've got a little of the, his dying pain. He got, after he was knocked down, his breath began to come very suddenly, and he was gasping for air. That was the feeling I was going through. And this wasn't, I don't think this was air. I don't think this was during wartime at all. I think this has happened during peacetime. It'd be interesting to find out if there was an accident of this sort.
I mean, I can remember Mavis saying to me, Jackie, are you cold? And I said, no, I'm as warm as toast. And she said, I'm absolutely frozen.
And how long did it last for?
Oh, all night. But Jackie said maybe the priest hall, maybe the draft coming.
No, there's no, I mean, you go up and have a look afterwards.
I couldn't feel a draft, but there was something, just the cold was like nothing I've ever experienced, really.
Somebody mentioned a watch, something happened to a watch. As you know, we get an enormous amount of sort of camera things like that play around with us.
Yes, you do. It's wound up. When I looked at it this morning, it had stopped and it was 1 o'clock. And as you can see,
it's now 25 past, isn't it?
It's 25 past one.
And you just noticed.
Well, I got it out to look what time it was.
This morning, it had stopped. It's been stopped for 6 hours.
It was 1 o'clock and it had stopped.
Now, Sandra, what did you need to find as your concept?
I would like to know about 5 o'clock this morning. Who was knocking on all the doors?
5 o'clock this morning?
Who was knocking on all the doors? Was it somebody waking everybody up?
Not at 5 o'clock in the morning.
Is it between 5 and 5:30?
No. Did anybody else hear that?
In your sleep.
You sure about this? You went to sleep?
No, I wasn't asleep.
Could you have been asleep?
No, I wasn't asleep.
How do you know you went to sleep?
Because I was awake.
Putting it into context of Chingle, a very quiet night, but I think that one could say that from your point of view, I think quite interesting, because really, as I said, I think last night, it's very much a question of fairly minor things not to frighten you, but just to give you a message, if you like.